All That Stuff on BCTV is supported by the Renaissance Auction Group.
Hello, friends, and welcome to a special episode of All That Stuff, another in the series of Women in Auctioneering. I will confess we are taping this. It is Tuesday, January 30th, and it is extremely cold outside. My phone gave me the snow squall alert at 3 o'clock. So we're happy to be safely ensconced here in the BCTV studio in downtown Albright College for another episode of Women in Auctioneering. Our guest today is a Virginia auctioneer. Her name is Amberleigh Wankel. I'm going to read a very brief intro, the only non-extemporaneous thing I ever do on my shows, and we're going to jump right in. Amberleigh Wankel is a personal property and liquidation auctioneer who lives in King George, Virginia. She has an extensive background in all aspects of the auction industry. Amberleigh and her husband, Ryan Wankel, specialize in antiques and collectibles, employing a variety of marketing methods and auction formats to serve their clients' asset conversion needs. So, Amberleigh Wankel, welcome to All That Stuff, Women in Auctioneering. It's nice to have you.
Thank you.
All right. And we finally got going here. We had a little technical difficulty, but we're back. We're going to start right out. So tell us and tell our audience how you got started in the auction industry or what inspired you.
Well, first auction I went to was about 15, across the street from my parents' house. And it wasn't the first exposure I had to auction. It was just the first one that I was aware of. I had been to one when I was about 2 years old, and I was very, very, very interested in fictional auctions, in mostly mystery novels. So when I saw the auction, I was excited to go. And from that point on, my mom actually started becoming an antique dealer, and she just took the entire family with her to the auctions weekly. And I just started to get a little bit bored sitting in the audience and decided, hey, what if I just become a clerk? And so I did that, and I sort of packed that and decided that maybe I could be an auctioneer. And that's where I went to auction school and everything else. I guess sprouted from that.
Okay. We're getting a little audio difficulty. Is our viewers hearing the same thing I'm hearing, John? Okay, well, we'll give it a try here, and if not, maybe we can work on it a little bit. Fortunately, we are taping today, and it is one of those days, so I guess nature might be playing some tricks on us. So based on those early experiences, now this is one thing I got to ask you that's interesting, is you said you were fascinated about reading about auctions and novels. Well, you know, I read a lot as a kid, and I was the son of a reading teacher. I don't think I ever read about auctions. Where did you find auctions in books?
Honestly, the most prominent one I remember is out of the Hercule Poirot novels by Agatha Christie.
Oh.
And from Basil Rathbone's Sherlock Holmes, the I can't remember the name of the movie, but it was The Adventure of a Music Box, and during an auction, he purchased a music box. I don't think he purchased a music box, but someone purchased a music box that figured very, very prominently in the story later on.
Well, interesting. Well, I didn't read Hercule Poirot, although as an adult, I did watch him on TV. I did read Sherlock Holmes, but that was a little later in my life. Okay.
Well, it's not canon. It was Basil Rathbone's story only, so that was actually a movie version of it. It was more toward the 1940s versions of it rather than an actual Victorian auction. So it was definitely a little bit different and had a little bit different time period to it, but it still fascinated me how the auction figured into. Honestly, very hilariously, both of the auctions in those stories have smuggling aspects where someone has consigned an item that contains a hidden item with the purpose of conveying it to another person secretly. So not exactly real-life stuff, but really fascinating.
Yeah, well, it's interesting, too, that it shows how those things that sometimes those things that we first become introduced to as a child stick in our minds, you know, like the people. And I never was one of those. I told you once on the phone not long ago that I wanted to be a lawyer and president of the United States. And I didn't become that thing that I always wanted to be as a kid. But a lot of people do. And that's another interesting example. So you went to auctions early on and did that. And what made you think, though, I mean, you know, when you, let's say when you told your parents, assuming that, you know, you did, hey, I think I want to be an auctioneer as opposed to, you know, being a doctor or a lawyer or an Indian chief. What'd they say, and what made you think that you wanted to be make a career out of an auction?
The performance aspect of it, definitely. Being in the limelight, being there in front of people, and being a charismatic entertainer. That was absolutely, like, the biggest thing I enjoyed about the idea of Japan.
Huh, that's interesting. Well, this may lead right on the next question, although the answer may not be related. What do you enjoy most about being a professional auctioneer?
Now, I really like looking for deals and finding things that I can flip quickly, which isn't technically purely about auctioneering. I also like competition, and I like Japan and the live auction. So, since a lot of the world and a lot of my business into internet auctions and buying and reselling, that definitely is something that I miss about what happens in the city.
Okay, when you say competition, you like the competition, did you mean bid calling competition, or did you mean the competition between auctioneers and working for jobs and things like that?
Definitely bid calling competition.
Okay, all right. Profit and loss notwithstanding, not necessarily what you or your favorite auctions to do as far as the most money that you make or that that help pay the mortgage. Do you have a favorite kind of auction?
Yeah, just the good old fashioned pull it out of the house, throw it out on the yard, and have people show up to bid it, and always will be my favorite. But it, you know, the work aspect of that, where you actually set the auction up, just isn't practical very much, but I enjoy the communication between customer and auctioneer, and I enjoy conducting the auction and helping people understand what's happening from the block. And that will always be the foundation of what I love about auctioneering, regardless of what other aspects I get into, and maybe those experiences will be fewer and farther between, but definitely that's there.
I would have to agree with you. I mean, I think all of us who got into the auction business doing live auctions and have attended live auctions and have worked live auctions and have conducted live auctions really enjoy that aspect of it overall, particularly when it's going on and when it's done. You know, but it's all that time leading up to it sometimes, and all of the all of the demands and the anxiety. As I said to Jason a couple of weeks ago, Jason Roski, our professional colleague who was on a regular episode of All That Stuff, it's part circus and part theater, and that means that there's a whole lot of moving parts to it. But that kind of segues us into another question. You're the master of segues. Do you have a particular, and you've kind of answered this, something that you enjoy the most, but as far as professionally, do you have a format, live with online bidding, online only, that you employ more often than others, or that you feel is your primary format?
Today, the best way that I prefer to sell things is online.
Okay, and that's all online only, right?
That's a money-based decision.
Mm-hmm.
It's more profitable, it's less labor-intensive, there's not as much overhead, there's no warehousing, hauling, all of those things factor a lot in how much it costs per dollar made. And honestly, none of them really change the end dollar amount that a user will pay for it, except maybe having a live only auction does sometimes reduce the prices that bidders will pay if they don't want to direct play for those items that they really want to get, where it's easier for them to bid from their living room, and then to know if they want it. So I would say really online selling is where it's at for me.
Okay. Do you have live previews for your online auctions?
Sometimes, and sometimes not. Depends.
Okay.
Some clients demand it. Obviously, if the client insists on it, it's going to happen. Do I think it's practical? Not really. Because I think that the descriptions and the photographs should be so spot on that people don't need to see it and they don't need to ask questions about it. I think you should be able to answer any question they have in your thorough item description and the excellent photograph that you take.
I would agree with that. I would agree with that for the most part. I think it's somewhat of a legacy, a leftover from when and from people who feel like they have to touch it. And I think it also has to do with people's confidence in the auctioneer, the auction company, the auction entity. If they come to the point of dealing with you that they know that your pictures are good and they know that your descriptions are complete and accurate, then I don't think they have any problem. And a lot of that, I believe, has been boosted by the fact that over time, now we buy lots of things online, right? I mean, we buy televisions, we buy cars, we buy just about anything you can think of online. And I think the overall trend of buying online has made people more comfortable with online-only auctions with or without previews. Because I have a building and because the items are generally in my building when I'm cataloging them and photograph them, I still have online live previews, but I find that, you know, over the years of 12 years of doing online only auctions, that fewer and fewer people attend them.
Yeah. I agree. That's also my experience.
Okay, well, you had a rather auspicious beginning into your auction career what many people, as I said in the sample questions I sent you, consider the calling card of the auction industry. You've already addressed the fact that bid calling, once you become an auctioneer and have your own company, you realize that bid calling plays only a small role in being a successful professional auctioneer. All that aside, you had a rather auspicious beginning in your auction career. Can you tell us a little bit about what happened when you entered Virginia Auctioneers Association State Bid Calling Contest in, I believe it was 2005 or 6?
2006, yes. I graduated from auction school in February of 2005, and I did compete in Virginia's rookie contest, I believe, the following January after I graduated. And I did not win that. There was actually a scoring error where we sort of poaching it, because I kind of finished the win, and then I found the scoring error later. So that was kind of big boost to like what people thought of me, I guess, as, you know, because when I found that there was an error, right, so that was exciting. A lot of people came from that already, and then I went ahead and competed in the state championship. There were 19 men and 2 women. They did not have separate divisions, and I won first half.
Well, so on your first state bid calling contest, you were winner, whereas the other bid calling contest had an error, or was that your second state bid calling contest?
No, it was the first state bid calling contest. The other one was the rookie contest.
Okay. All right. So you won as a woman in a contest that had both men and women, and you won in the first year you competed.
I did.
Yeah.
Awesome. Well,
that must have felt pretty good, huh?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, that brings up a question. What you were competing in what I refer to as a unified contest where men and women compete together.
Correct.
And I find that more and more states have unified bid calling contests. Quite a few national, and there are only so many national bid calling contests, but some of the most prominent have men and women's divisions. Do you have any insights on that about, you know, the positive or the negative, or what you would you prefer to have unified bid calling contests at the national level as well?
I prefer unified contests all the way. I don't think it's necessary to separate men and women as auctioneers in any contest or competition. And And the reason for that is because when you do have a separate contest, I feel like it implies that men and women would have different skills for some reason. I don't believe that men and women have different skills as auctioneers. I believe that different specialties have different skills. So you might have a benefit auctioneer, you might have an automobile auctioneer, you have a tobacco auctioneer, I mean, not more. You know, you may have at one point. The different specialties, I think, could be a ground. And in fact, they already are, because they have the World Automobile Championship and they have the World Livestock Championship. Then they have everybody else's championship. And I feel if they need more than one representative, more than one group of auctioneers, specialties would be a better way to put it than nailing.
You know, nobody's ever made that point, but that is an excellent point, I think. Because in some ways, the national contests and even some state contests have developed a very formulaic sense of what an auctioneer should sound like. And it tends to lean toward livestock and auto. You know,
yes, but it's the most fun to listen to.
Yeah, you know, it's fast, it's quick, it's what fast pace, you can tap your feet, you know, and it seems like the most tongue-twisting and difficult, it seems like the 10.0 on the gymnastics scale. But by the same token, I was thinking about this earlier today when I was getting ready for the show. If you go to the biggest auction houses in the country, Sotheby's, Christie's, Heritage, you won't find many livestock type chants or auctioneer, car auctioneer type chants. It doesn't mean one is better than the other, but I do think that that's one of the reasons. I think another reason is, you know, and we're going to talk about this a little later in the show in a very interesting segment, I think very fascinating, that, you know, there was a bias toward men in earlier in our industry and in our profession. The bias may still be there, but it's not nearly as large. And therefore, that style became what was accepted and what people think of as, oh, an auctioneer. That's the way an auctioneer talks. You know, can you talk fast? That's what everybody asks us, right? That's the first thing they ask when they find out we're an auctioneer. Can you talk fast like that? So I think that probably impacted to some degree. So in some ways, when they first started having men and women's contests, it was to say, okay, well, you know, women call differently than men, and, you know, we want to give the women a chance. And they began to realize that all of a sudden, you know, there was some proactive, pardon the expression, affirmative action that needed to be taken to make sure that the many competent women were represented in our industry and bid calling as well. But I'm with you. I think the time has come that we need unified bid calling contests, because I believe in the end that there are plenty of women bid callers out there right now. It's proven on the state level over and over. It's proven by you. Women are winning state bid calling contests with regularity. So now I think maybe it's time for us to do that on the national level and put some pressure on our national judges to rethink that epitome that they have of what an auctioneer should sound like. Just my opinion. Well, let's talk a little bit. Go ahead, please.
Oh, another issue that I see when it comes to the men versus women aspect of the larger contest is a lot of what they do is a standardized form of auctioneering that doesn't necessarily apply to a different specialty. So, for example, you might have a livestock auctioneer competing in the National Auctioneer Championship, and on that day, at that time, the protocol is to wear a suit and a tie, but clearly he doesn't do that in his everyday job, and were he competing in the livestock championship, they would be like, well, what's up with this dude, you know? So I think that's another aspect that's different. I mean, if you're a benefit auctioneer as a female, when you do the auctions in real life, you're going to be wearing a very nice sequined evening gown.
Right.
And at the, you know, National Auctioneer Contest, you're definitely not going to be doing that. And so it becomes unrealistic. It's a state performance.
I think you really hit on something here. Wouldn't it be cool, too, if instead of having, like, a man's champion and a woman's champion, that you had the benefit auctioneer champion and the car auctioneer champion and the, you know, and the livestock auctioneer champion? Now, in fairness, quite a few of those, particularly automobiles and livestock, have their own championship series, you know, with their own organizations. But I think from a national standpoint, for a national organization to have a champion in each one of those areas. To follow up with what you say, if a livestock auctioneer walked into a benefit auction, I know I'm probably going to hear from them say, well, we do benefit auctions all the time, but if they walked into a benefit auction for a children's hospital in Philadelphia and started in with their normal livestock chant, half the audience would have no idea in the world what bid increment they were on, how much money they were asking for. So, you know, and I think that brings up another point. Good professional auctioneers know how to change their style as well. But I like that idea a lot. I hope that when some of our professional colleagues are watching this as we share it around, that they might consider that idea. So let's talk a little bit now about being a professional, successful professional woman in the auctioneering industry and in the auctioneer profession. You know, it's, we've alluded to this already, reputed to be a male-dominated industry. I've asked this question of every guest I've had on women in auctioneering. I have my own opinions, which I've expressed over and over, but I'd like to hear yours. Do you perceive of the auction profession today as being male-dominated?
For the most part, it depends on where you look. If you look in say, automobile auctions, I would say that it's definite yes. If you look in small business owners who are running their own gig, who are doing their own thing, especially benefits, I would go with a definite no. I think it's also geographical. I think it depends on who people see as the main competitor in your area. So, you know, if there's been a long-standing and long-established auction company in a certain area, and they just get all the business because people have been around for so long, that area could be perceived, whether it's deliberate, whether it's accidental, that area could be perceived as a yes. And if you go somewhere farther out where there isn't an established leader of competition, then the answer might be no. It's a lot about perspective. It's a lot about personal experience. I don't think there's any one right answer.
Okay. I can understand that. And once again, you pointed to the different segments of the industry, which is probably very accurate. If you talk about benefit auctioneers, it was traditionally, and is only becoming less so, female-dominated. Automobile auctions, male-dominated. Personal property auctions and auction companies owned by men and women, I think we see a relatively even split in the industry. So that's an interesting point as well. Let me ask you, you know, not necessarily asking for any specifics, but just a simple insights into it. Have you ever experienced discrimination based on gender in the auction industry yourself?
My immediate reaction would be yes, but that's the problem with talking about the issue of discrimination, because unless you have, you know, solid facts and basis to go on, it's almost impossible to think whether it's yes or question. You can't be entirely sure. It's so mysterious, and everybody is so hush-hush about it, including, you know, for women who've experienced it, definitely not a lot of sharing about specific experiences. Nobody wants to hurt anybody's feelings. So it's almost impossible to give a straight answer to questions, even if you're quite sure somewhere inside. Just it's very difficult to discuss the detail.
That's kind of the insidious aspect of any type of discrimination, unless it's very overt. Unless you're told to your face, you know, I don't like you because of your gender or your ethnicity, you know, or your religion or whatever. It is a very difficult thing to say for sure. So I think you just simply have to go on your on your sense and on your belief. And in that sense, your answer was, yes, you know, your sense is that perhaps sometimes you might have experienced gender discrimination, but you don't know for sure. Would that be a fair synopsis?
Yeah, and, you know, I think certain people, will sometimes tell anyone, but a woman something, that, you know, they believe represents the views of the people around them. So you might hear a definite statement from one person, but again, you can't be sure if it truly represents all of the people that they represent. Unless you go around and take a survey, which is clearly not going to happen. So, I can't be sure. I don't know if anyone can be sure. I've never heard of a story where anyone was like 100% positive. And you know, I think it would be an important thing that if anyone does have a story that they can tell that is definite fact, you know, irrefutable, that it would be important to share that. To let other people know that it's okay to talk about
it. Yeah, I think that is a very important point as well, you know, because what I have sensed in asking that question of our guest on the Women in Auctioneering series as part of all that stuff is that nobody really wants to say, heck yeah, I have, because then, you know, they become kind of a bad sport, or, you know, maybe they get branded in the industry as a maverick or somebody that's just, whining and crying. So I would agree with you. I think it is important that we discuss it, and I think it's important that if we have very specific examples, that we have the courage to state that. Now, that's easy for me. Because when in the sense of I'm in that, if there is a dominant profession in the auction industry, and I am one that believes that across the totality there is not a dominant profession, but I believe there is a perception of a dominant profession. I mean, because I've been in this industry now for 38 years, and I know how many competent, talented, successful women at all levels, not just auctioneers, but auction company owners, all the roles that make a successful auction company. So I don't believe that this profession is male dominated, but I believe there is a perception that it's male dominated. And I think that in the sense of the organizations, sometimes the organizations are male dominated. And that's a segue into the next question. And once again, this is your sense of. Do you see if there is a gender imbalance or if there is gender discrimination in the auction profession? Do you see it getting better? Do you see it simply stagnant? Or do you see it regressing?
That's a difficult answer. I don't like to make anecdotal deductions based on my personal experiences, because it's such a narrow view of the big picture. I feel like the biggest issue facing, diversity is lack of data. I think that no surveys, there's no questions being asked, there's no anonymous ability to be able to tell your experience as part of an aggregate problem. I don't think we have a good picture of the scope of the problem and how much the training actually needs to be done.
I would agree that we do not actually have hard data on whether it is getting better. As far as perception, my sense is it is getting better only because we're talking about it more and because we're seeing more women occupy positions in state organizations, and we're seeing more women win bid calling contests, etc. You know, so I think it's getting better. But I would agree with you that there is no hard data, so that's only a sense, only right. A perception.
The danger that you fall into when observing, say, like women in state leadership, is that the potential for, you know, maybe a state board or something as a collective group, say, well, look, we have a woman. I'm sure women are doing fine.
Yeah.
One problem could be, you know, there's 40 or 50 women who aren't on that board who may not be experiencing the same level of success as one or two or three or five or however many women are on a board. I mean, you could have an all-women board and it represent a very, very minor fraction of women who put themselves out to become leadership, but they can't get anything done. It just depends on each individual circumstance and so. I wouldn't want to make any conclusions or deductions without enough data to draw from.
I think those are both very valid points, and it reminds me of a discussion we had a couple years ago when at that time on one prominent national organization that purports to represent the entire auction industry, there were 14 members on the board, and they were all 14 white males. And when some of us bought that up and said, you know, this just doesn't seem to be representative of our industry, there was one individual who was prominent and actually has run at least once for that board, maybe running again, who kept saying, well, he kept posting a picture of the one female president that organization had ever had. Said, see, that disputes your argument right there. You know, that disputes your argument because we've had one female president. So there is the risk of the token. And as you pointed out, which I think is a much more subtle point, that even if you had 14 women on the board, it wouldn't necessarily mean that there was not a gender discrimination element across the board. Because another thing, and you know, that's a double entendre not intended there, that doesn't mean that throughout the industry as a whole there's not. And I think that's another problem we have too with some of our organizations. You know, we're not representing the vast majority of auctioneers in the country. Now, they're not members. You can't represent people that aren't members unless you choose to. If you choose to really represent them anyway, but if your goal is to represent your members and you have 2 or 3 or 5 or 6% of the auctioneers in the country as members, then it's very difficult to say that you represent the industry as a whole or even come close to it. Another question though, you were recently, and we're just segueing ourselves to death here today, you were recently elected to the Virginia Auctioneers Association Board of Directors, is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay, and that was just this year, right?
Yes, just in January.
Okay, and I saw a post of yours maybe a year, just a Facebook post once again, for those who don't know or can't assume what we're talking about. We believe it or not, we auctioneers have all sorts of forums, I'm sure you believe that, and we love to talk. I know that comes as a surprise to you. And we love to express our opinions. I'm speaking to our viewers now. So this is when I say I saw a post. I'm usually talking about an auctioneer forum. In which you had some definite concepts about how we might address any real gender imbalance that exists. So as a newly minted member at the Virginia Auctioneers Association, do you have any thoughts in mind about initiatives or things you might suggest about how the Virginia Auctioneers Association might ensure that all members are represented equally and that all members have equal opportunities?
Well, I think that part of that is work as a network with other associations that represent profession, and I'm aware of a diversity initiative of some type going on in the Auctioneers Association, but it seems that it's been unwrapped for quite a long time, and there's no public, I don't know what to exactly call it, but it can't be seen by the public. No mention of the website. Articles being written about it, there's Facebook posts, advertising. And I think one of the big challenges to overcome would be to make sure that people understand what is actually happening behind the scenes. So part of, I guess, the initial phase that I would undertake as a member of the Board of Directors of the State of would just be myself become aware of what's going on behind the scenes, and then to see how it can be brought more into the public. I believe there are initiatives already underway in many areas, but I don't really think they can effective unless the public can see that something's being done about it. So that both the general public and also the auctioneers aren't going to ask for the question if they can't see what's being done by the association. It doesn't provide much for them to participate.
I think the key word there is public. I believe I would concur that initiatives that are being made lack a public face. You know, and you know, you can make if you're not out there, if you don't have an outcry. Now, this is one case where live is better. Live is better than silent or online. You know, if you don't have an outcry, then your initiative probably isn't drawing as much attention, perhaps as you might like it to. You've been in the auction industry for over a decade now. How, if at all, how have your attitudes and the way you approach the auction profession and your insights changed over that decade, if they have?
I changed from a total optimist to a realist in life in general.
That's called aging, by the way. Just kidding. Go ahead.
But no, I think part of one of the things that has changed for me is that I actually, seriously, no joke, even talking about me, went into the whole industry with an open mind and listened to bunches of things that bunches of people told me, you know, just trying to collect data for myself. And after being around for 10 years, I expected some things to evolve. And certain things that I expected to evolve have not evolved. So for myself, I'm kind of taking a different line than the rest of the profession. And I'm going outside the profession to look for needs of clients and consumers and trying to figure out how not to compete with the rest of the auction industry. I don't think that's a competition. I think it's a movement or a you. I'm trying to figure out how to compete with their industry, because I think that's probably where the whole crux of the matter lies. You have major online retailers that are supplying people with things they need at the top of the hat, and you have auctioneers who are also supplying people with things that they need on an everyday basis, not necessarily in a convenient, quick, or appealing of a form.
Okay. Well, to reflect on that, one thing, Winston Churchill has a very famous quote, which I never have exactly agreed with, but it is, in paraphrase, if you're young and you're not liberal, you don't have a heart, and if you're old and you're not conservative, you don't have a brain. So maybe that's a part of that evolving process that you just spoke about in your own mind. Once again, that's not a quote that I necessarily agree with, but it's one that I find has some kernel of interest to it. Advice you might give to women who want to enter the auctioneering profession, women of all ages, you know, from young ladies, even young girls like yourself who became interested in the auction industry and began in it at an early age, a young womanhood, advice you might give or insights you might offer?
I think for anyone, my advice would be get as far away from the box as possible. Don't think in it, don't be in it, don't look at it, don't even know where the box is. Because the box is a box. And I think that the most important thing for anybody starting a new business or starting a new profession is, with all of the technology, social media, and everything that we have going on that's changing the face of commerce in the world, the most important thing is to explore new everything. Just make it all new. Not saying that you spent not contributing, and definitely take into account the expertise of people who came before you, but certainly not digging this old way of doing things just because that's the way it's always been done.
Well, that's very interesting. I think that's exceptional advice. Are you? Is your mic attached in any way to your clothing? Are you wearing a clip on your mic?
No, I'm just using my computer mic.
Okay. All right, just checking. Yeah, I think that's fine advice. And I think it's good advice for anybody. And I might add, doesn't mean, and you weren't implying, and I'm not implying that you were. I'm not implying you were implying. It doesn't mean that you don't listen to what other people have to say, that maybe you don't take courses, maybe that you don't take educational courses to learn how other people have done things. But don't feel like you have to emulate, and don't feel like that there's a path that if you follow it, you know, that somebody can give you a prescription for success. So I think that's exceptional advice.
I think the most important thing is not necessarily to follow it like a recipe, step one, step two, step three. Especially in a lot of industries, a lot of people will tell you, oh, this is how you get your foot in the door. Well, no, it's not.
And that reminds me, one of my favorite things that one of my oldest friends, Don Hart, down in Butler, Tennessee, used to say, a recipe is just a suggestion. So when he cooks, to him, a recipe is just a suggestion. You have a specific cause. Now we're going to jump right back into the box. From out of the box, we're going to jump right back into the middle of the box here. You have a cause that you have been promoting for several years that relates to our profession and relates to an individual that was... that was one of the early women pioneers in our profession. Could you explain a little bit about that to our viewers?
Yes. Her name is Emma Bailey, and she was known as the first woman auctioneer in America. She was from Vermont, and she ran a family auction business for a long time. She was also the first woman member ever of the National Auctioneers Association. And my campaign for many years has been try to get her recognized in some way by the National Auctioneers Association, whether that be a dedication of some type of award or possibly a thing award or some type of basically recognition, just that, you know, she was a pioneer and she did a hero for the rest of us for women in the industry today.
Well, I think that's reasonable. I remember when I first read about that in a post that you posted 2 or 3 years ago, I immediately signed the petition, signed up, because I thought it was a good idea. I think at the time you were asking that she be inducted in the National Auctioneers Hall of Fame, it seems only reasonable to me that someone who broke the gender barrier in an organization would be an ideal candidate. So I only knew so much about Emma Bailey. I remember you're talking about it and always stayed in the back of my mind, but like everybody, I get busy. But I did a little research, and I only had time to do it this morning, and I just got more and more fascinated. I'd like to read. I said I don't do anything extemporaneous, but I'm gonna read a few more things here from a Wikipedia entry. That is on Emma Bailey. And I will remind people that what is written in Wikipedia is a collaborative effort. Oftentimes you go to Wikipedia, you look and they'll say, you know, this needs to be verified or that needs to be verified. But I'm going to start with this first. This is an ad that Emma Bailey put in the Brattleboro, Vermont newspaper in April of 1950. The Bailey Auction Barn on Black Mountain Road is prepared to handle auction sales, courteous and efficient handling of all consignments, large and small. We will sell anything from a plate to an estate. Signed, Emma Bailey, Brattleboro's woman auctioneer, April 1950. And then there is another entry a little further down that says, in 1952, after applying to the National Auctioneers Association, Bailey was accepted as the first female member of the association. She handled her auction sales for almost 20 years before retiring at the peak of her career in the late 1960s. She wrote a book about her experiences titled Sold to the Lady in the Green Hat, which was published in 1962. I assume you've read that book? I have not.
It's been a while since I read it, but I did.
Anything in the book that any anecdote or story or anything or any insights or any theme that stood out to you about that book?
I really enjoy the way she walks the readers through her struggles as a female auctioneer, and I think that it's must read. Pretty much everybody who's interested in diversity or inclusion in the auction business.
Okay, and I'm going to read one more paragraph. During her time as auctioneer, Bailey encountered some opposition based on her gender. I'm reading this simply because it leads into the into a lot of what we've been discussing about. During her time as auctioneer, Bailey encountered some opposition based on her gender. Her first auction was postponed for several weeks after a male competitor accused her of breaking a zoning law. Later, when Bailey and a rival male auctioneer both expressed interest in the same sale, the man proposed that he should get the sale because, quote, he had a family to support, whereas Bailey already had a working husband. Bailey lost the sale. Despite her induction in the National Auctioneers Association, Bailey was not always well supported by her peers. In 1960, when a reporter inquired about women auctioneers, the association's response was that, quote, although a woman had tried auctioneering in Vermont, she had found it too hard and quit, unquote. Now, if nothing else, I believe we can say that our sense, now this is 1960s, remember, that we have made some progress. And I thought about another thing when I read that. If anyone hasn't seen The Basis of Sex, and if you have seen The Basis of Sex, the Hollywood-style movie out about Ruth Bader Ginsburg, it's well worth remembering. It's well worth seeing. The movie is. We saw it. We enjoyed it. But it's well worth remembering that even in the late 60s and early 70s, women couldn't get credit cards in their own name. You know, there was a plethora of assumptions and stereotypes that had wrapped women in chains, basically binds, whatever you want to call it, had bound their feet and hands, to use a Japanese analogy. Title IX hadn't been passed at that time, so you didn't have equality in women's sports. Any insight on that?
I think that the situation with any type of gender discrimination and all that stuff, it, like you talked about before, it's hard to pin down. And I think, as far as like Emma Bailey's book in particular, that, you know, it, she's sharing the story that I think we often share. And then, you know, so when you talk about her contacting the NEA, the reporter contacting the NAA years later to ask about her and her not getting recognition. I mean, there's going to be mixed experiences with that happening today. Sometimes people are going to be lost in the shuffle, and sometimes they're going to be recognized, and that's where you get your, oh, look, we have a woman over here, or, I mean, I've had it happen where people are supposed to know who I am and don't, and I'm like, okay, why? And there's hardly any explanation for it. So the whole thing is so complicated that it's difficult to nail it down to one concise response.
Okay, and out of accuracy, although we're once again talking about a Wikipedia entrance, apparently that question was asked in 1960. It wasn't asked recently. Now you, go ahead.
The thing with that, you know, that being asked, like, you know, if a reporter were to ask the NAA about Emma Bailey today, I'm sure that they would be directed to the museum or the foundation that curates the fact of Emma Bailey specifically. But yet, I don't know how far we've truly come on that, because there is no official recognition of her. So, have we come that far? I don't know the answer.
Yes, we would. If nothing else, we would hope that the answer would be more nuanced than it was in 1960, right? By the way, another thing that this resolved for me is that there is an auctioneer, Carol Miller, who's in Wisconsin, and she is a member of the Wisconsin Hall of Fame, and she has an auction company called Bailey's Honor LLC. And I never knew why it was called Bailey's Honor LLC till I read that Wikipedia entrance, and it is an honor of Emma Bailey. I will add, and many people may not see this show in time, but perhaps they will, Carol's having a great auction. It's closing 2 p.m. Central Time, day one, and day two closes tomorrow. Remember, we are taping this Wednesday, January 30th. Day one is closing at 2 p.m. Central, which means it started closing 7 minutes ago. And I'm sure they're closing in catalog order, and they're closing with a soft close. And day two will close tomorrow. It is an exceptional auction of contents from a Victorian home. All right, we've got maybe 7 minutes or so to go. What do you find is your greatest challenge as an auctioneer? Not as necessarily as a woman auctioneer, just as an auctioneer.
Making money.
Yeah.
Honestly, it's difficult to make sure that today, in the age of digital, social media, and electronic, difficult to make sure that everything you do doesn't get off. And there's a lot of noise, and you have to get your message to the right people in the right place at the right time to make sure that people see what you have available. Service, whether it's them, it doesn't matter what it is, you have to make sure that it doesn't lock in the shop. Because if it does, then you don't end up getting the right people to see what they want and bid on it, which in turn means you don't make money.
Okay, and I think part of what you noted there, which are very accurate perceptions, applies to a lot of businesses and a lot of small businesses, huh?
Sure.
Yeah. What would you perceive as some of your greatest rewards in your career as an auctioneer? You know, acting as an auctioneer. What are some of your greatest rewards being an auctioneer?
Definitely, I would top that list off with winning a state championship. That was definitely a crowning moment. I met my husband through the auction business, so that's very cool.
Two sterling moments, right?
Yeah. Right. My best friend is an auctioneer, and most of my finest acquaintances are auctioneers. So I think personal connections is probably the biggest thing that I've gotten out of the auction business that couldn't have come from any other small business. I mean, as far as, you know, learning my craft and making money and all that stuff, you know, I could do that in almost a business that I trained. It would just depend on which trades I went. But the specific people that I've become acquainted with wouldn't have come from anywhere except the auction professional.
Okay. Our industry is undergoing a significant changes, I think. You know, the way we acquire clients, the way we sell items, competition from a lot of new sources. What do you perceive as some of the greatest challenges to professional auctioneers now in general in relation to their profession?
I think we've touched on that subject a couple of times already during this short discussion when we talked about competition and when we talked about noise on the internet and media. I think that standing out from the crowd and letting people know that we exist is probably the biggest challenge. And I think that may be the case for almost any small business owner. But I think that with online retailers supplying people with so much of what they need so easily, I think that it's a challenge for auctioneers to let people know that it could be cheaper and even better if you get it secondhand. And I think another big challenge, not necessarily for auctioneers, so I don't know that they're necessarily thinking about it, but definitely younger auctioneers, is trying to show people that engineering, reselling used items and secondhand have a big impact. I think that forget to take into account both professionals within the industry and then people who don't even know that it's a viable way to buy things that aren't newly manufactured.
Okay, I have time for one last question in what has been, I think, a very informative and interesting program. Do you have any new horizons you're looking forward to exploring in the auction profession that you can think of specifically?
I try to do things like that in smaller pieces, smaller bites. I don't have like a big end goal because the world shifts so quickly and so much. Tomorrow there might be, I don't know, fake number two, or I don't know, Amazon can go bankrupt. That would taint everything. So I try to be trying to identify the needs of people live in my community and serve those needs. And sometimes it has only to do with, sometimes it has to do with using what I've learned in the auction industry to provide services. So I don't really have a big end. When I'm older, I don't know, I have small that I eat, probably on a year.
When I'm 64. All right, Amberleigh Wankel. I have enjoyed this conversation very much. It took us a while to get around to it with your busy schedule. And I'm looking forward to getting a chance. We've never met in person. Looking forward to getting a chance to meeting you in person sometime and continuing this conversation. So thank you so much for appearing on the Women in Auctioneering segment of All That Stuff. And look forward to seeing you again.
You too. Thank you.
All right. Take care. Friends, thank you so much for joining us and for this special Women in Auctioneering episode of All That Stuff. I'll remind you that Auction Action on BCTV will be coming up with a new episode in a month or two. So if you have items that you'd like to consign, feel free to contact me. And if you can't remember how to contact me, then just call BCTV and tell them to put you in touch with the auction guys. So our advice right now is hunker down, stay warm. Bring the pets inside, get you some chili, some mac and cheese, a good cup of hot cider, and we'll look forward to seeing you in about 2 weeks on a regular episode of All That Stuff. And as always, thanks for supporting Berks Community Television, Berks County's voice to the world.
All That Stuff on BCTV is supported by the Renaissance Auction Group.